agriculture in India. In the previous chapter, we have learned about the characteristics of Indian agriculture, the problems faced by the Indian farmers, the various steps or measures taken by the government to improve the agricultural sector or to reduce the problems faced by the Indian farmers. And we have also learned that there are a variety of agricultural practices in India. So as a result of those agricultural practices, we can grow a large variety of crops in India, and the credit goes to the geographical location. That is, India is at such a geographical location that variety of climatic conditions are experienced in the country. So because of all types of climatic conditions ranging from tropical to temperate is experienced in India, so variety of crops grow. Tropical crops as well as temperate crops both grow in India, and if we categorize them into two types, then the crops are food crops and cash crops. So what are food crops and what are cash crops? Let us know about this first, and then we will learn about the food crops grown in India, the regions where they are grown, and the methods that are used to cultivate them. So students, let's come to this side and see. Here I have written the difference as well as the definition is also written here. So what are cash crops? Cash crops are produced for its commercial value. This means they are grown to sell for profit. So the crops that are grown, not for consumption, but to sell them to earn profit, are cash crops. And cash crops include oil seeds like groundnut, mustard, coconut, sesame, etc. Plantation crops like tea, coffee, rubber. So oil seeds as well as plantation crops, all of them come under cash crops. Apart from these, other crops like sugarcane. Sugarcane is also a cash crop. Students, we know that sugarcane is used to produce sugar, and it is sold for, that's why it is sold for commercial value. Now students, the next one is food crop. So what are food crops? Crops that is grown to feed human population. So here the food crops means the crop that we consume directly so that our hunger is satisfied. So for nutritional value or to feed the population of a place or of a country or of a region, food crops are grown. So food crops include cereals, rice, wheat, maize, millet, and so on. They also include pulses like gram, moong, masoor. So I am sure students you have heard about moong and masoor. So it is prepared every day in our house, and it's like our staple food. Means we consume rice and pulses every day. It is a staple food of a large number of Indians. Now apart from cereals and pulses, the spices like cardamom, ginger, pepper, they are also food crops. Now you must be wondering why these spices, they are not like very compulsory as staple food, then why they are under the category of food crops. Students, the answer is because they are the parts of plants, either they are leaves, roots, stem, or they can be flower. So these are used to add taste to your food, and as they are parts of various parts of plants, so they are also categorized under food crops. So I hope you have understood this. This is all about the cash crops and food crops, and variety of cash crops and food crops are grown in different parts of India. And in this chapter, we will learn about the food crops grown in India, the climatic conditions required to grow these crops, and the methods of cultivation. Now, students, we will learn about the food crops in India, and in this we will learn about cereal crops and pulses. So we'll start with the cereal crop, and the major cereal crops that are grown in India are rice and wheat. Apart from these two, millets, maize, etc. are also grown in different parts of the country, but rice and wheat forms the major cereal crops that are grown in India. Now students, what is the importance? Why are cereal crops very important for us? And even we can say all over the world, cereal crops, they have their own importance. The reason is that cereal crops, or we can say the word cereal, it denotes all the grass-like plants, and they are starchy edible seeds. They have starchy edible seeds, and it is very easy to cultivate them. And you know, they have high nutritional value. And because of their high nutritional value, they are considered as the most common diet or staple food for a very large population all over the world. And therefore, they are often referred to as the staff of life, because they feed a huge number or a large number of population. Now students, I have written some points. Very easy to cultivate. So the cereal crops, it is very easy to cultivate them, and they have high nutritional value. They are staple food for millions of people, and tropical as well as subtropical crops. So the last point means that, for example, rice and wheat. I will just take rice for now. Rice can be grown in the terrace hills of Kashmir. It can be grown in the lowlands of northern India as well as in South India. So in every climatic condition, whether it is tropical or subtropical, is suitable for cultivation of rice. So it can be grown in different climatic conditions, and that is the benefit, that it becomes popular food crop, or we can specifically say it becomes a popular cereal crop. So similarly, wheat also is can be grown in different climatic conditions, and rice and wheat becomes the major cereal crops in India. Now students, we will start with rice. So rice is a kharif crop. As you remember, we have learned about the different seasons, growing seasons in India: rabi, kharif and zaid. So rice is a kharif crop, and it is the oldest cultivated cereal in the world. It was first grew as wild grass, and for the first time it was cultivated as food crop about 5000 BC in China, Thailand and Vietnam. So these are the places where first rice was cultivated as a food crop, and then from there it was introduced in India. And there are about 10,000 varieties of rice that grow all over the world. So can you imagine the varieties? There are 10,000 varieties, and out of which 4,000 types are grown in India. So we Indians, we can access up to about 4,000 types of rice as our staple food. So students, this is about rice, which is a kharif crop and oldest cultivated cereal in the world. Let's learn more about rice. Now students, we will learn about the types of rice grown in India, and we will also learn about the climatic conditions required for cultivation of rice. So let's start with the types of rice. So students, rice, as I have told you, is a kharif crop, and it is grown in the month from June to October. Sowing and harvesting, all the process is completed from June to October. Now the types of rice. So there are two types of rice. This is a broader classification: upland rice and lowland rice. So it is depending on the region where it grows. So the upland rice, it grows in the areas of higher altitude, like mountain slopes, hills and uplands. And lot of artificial irrigation cannot be provided in higher areas. It is difficult to provide, and therefore plenty of upland rice is not grown in India. It is limited to certain areas, that is the uplands of the country, like mountain slopes, hills and uplands, and the rice which is grown is mostly used for local consumption. The sowing season is March, April, and the season when it is harvested is September, October. Now students, after this, the upland rice, there is another type of rice which is grown in the low lying areas or plains of the country, and we can say it is grown in the deltas and river valleys. So the lowland rice is grown in river valleys and deltas, as I have told you, and it requires a lot of irrigation. Students, in the lowland or in the plains, modes of irrigation can be well developed, like canals, wells, etc., and a lot of water can be provided to the agricultural field. As we know, India is a country of seasonal rainfall. So rainfall takes place only in a particular season, and rest of the year there is no rainfall. So to provide water through artificial means, the suitable modes are the canal irrigation, well irrigation. In South India, tank irrigation is very popular. So lowland rice, it requires a lot of irrigation, and it grows mostly in the fertile plains of the river valleys and deltas. And the sowing season is June and the harvesting season is October and November. And you know students, it is commonly grown in large part of the country. So this is it is grown in a very large part of the country, as the mode of irrigation is available. A lot of irrigation can be provided to in the plain areas of river valleys and delta. So this rice is most commonly grown in India. So this is about the types of rice: upland rice and lowland rice. Now students, next we will learn about the climatic conditions that are very much suitable for cultivation of rice in India. So what are they? What about the temperature? How much temperature is required? So during the growing stage, rice require temperature varying from 16 degrees Celsius to 20 degrees Celsius. And while ripening, during the ripening stage, when the crop is becoming ready to be harvested, the temperature required is from 18 degrees Celsius to 32 degrees Celsius. This temperature is very good and appropriate during the ripening stage. And if we see, the average temperature should be 24 degrees Celsius. And not to forget that bright sunshine is very necessary for rice during the growing and ripening stage. After temperature, let's look at the rainfall. How much rainfall is required? So it should vary from 150 centimeter to 300 centimeters, and the field should be flooded. When the seeds are sown, then the field should be flooded with water, and irrigation is required in areas with low rainfall. So in India, Punjab and Haryana, mostly these states, they experience low rainfall. So modes of irrigation play a very important role in cultivation of rice in these states. Now let's look at the soil. So what kind of soil is suitable for growing rice? The answer is alluvial soil. So no doubt, alluvial soil is found extensively in the river valleys and deltas. So alluvial soil is best suited soil for growing rice, and if it has a layer of impervious subsoil, then the impervious layer can hold water, and the field will remain flooded and the rice will grow very well. So students, it is said about rice that rice can grow even in the hilly terrace as a result of terrace farming, and it can even grow in the grows extensively all over the country and many several countries of the world, and it has become a very important staple crop for a large population all over the world. Now students, we will learn about the methods of cultivation. Here I mean the different methods of cultivating rice in India. So there are different several methods. We will start with this, that is broadcasting method. So this is the first method which is used to cultivate rice in India. So what is done in this method? Let's have a look. Seeds are sprinkled by hand all over the field. So a farmer sprinkles the seed in the field, all over the field with his hands, and this type of method, or that is broadcasting method, is used in areas with inferior quality of soil, where the soil is of inferior quality and where the labor is scarce, where there is scarcity of labor and the soil is not of very good quality. There the farmer sprinkles the seed with his hand all around the field. So now students, let's look at this picture. This picture, it's clearly shown that the farmer is sprinkling the seed all over the field, and this is how the broadcasting method is applied in areas of inferior quality soil and where the labor is scarce. The next method is dibbling method. So what is done in this method? Now students, seeds are dropped at regular intervals in the plowed furrows. Now here this means, if you see this picture, this will make it clear. The field is plowed and furrows are made, and then the seeds are dropped in the furrows. So this is dibbling method of rice cultivation. So what is the difference between these two methods, broadcasting and dibbling? Here the seeds are simply scattered in the field, whereas in dibbling method, furrows are made and then the seeds are dropped into the furrows. Now students, let's proceed to the third method. This is known as drilling method. In this method, the seeds are dropped through a bamboo shaft which is attached to the plow into the furrows. Now, what is done basically? In these first two methods, the seeds were dropped by the hand, but in this, the seeds are dropped into a bamboo shaft. Students, look at the picture. In this picture, you can see that a bamboo shaft is attached to the plow, and the farmer is dropping the seeds into the bamboo shaft from where it is reaching the furrows. Okay, I hope this is clear. So, if the drilling method is used, and it checks the wastage of seed, but it requires a lot of time and labor. So students, in broadcasting method, as we have learned, areas where laborers are not readily available, there the broadcasting method is done. But here, if drilling method has to be followed, a lot of labor is required, and it is also a time consuming method, and because it will go on slowly, but there will be no wastage of seeds. Seeds will not be wasted. In broadcasting method, and to a certain extent in dibbling method, seeds are wasted because several seeds might fall in a place and several might not germinate. Only few of them will germinate, so there will be a lot of wastage. But in this case of drilling method, there will be no wastage because gradually through the bamboo shaft, the seeds will fall into the furrows and they will fall at certain distance, and there will be no wastage of seeds. So this is about the drilling method. The next method of rice cultivation in India is transplantation method. Let's have a look. Seeds are first sown in the nurseries, and This is done at the beginning of the monsoon. As soon as the monsoon season starts or about to start, the seeds are sown in the nursery. And in the nursery, they are kept for 4 to 5 weeks. And in 4 to 5 weeks, they become 15 to 20 centimeters tall. So once again, in transplantation method, the seeds are sown in nursery in the first stage. And when they are sown in the beginning of monsoon. So beginning of the monsoon season, the seeds are sown in nursery and they are kept in the nursery for 4 to 5 weeks where they grow 15 to 20 centimeters tall. After the seedlings are ready, they are 50 to 20 centimeters long, they are uprooted and transplanted in the flooded fields. So students, after the seedlings are ready in the nursery, they are uprooted from there and they are transplanted in the flooded field. That's why the name is transplantation method, because they are uprooted from the nursery and they are transplanted in the flooded field. And this method definitely is labor intensive. And you know, in India, laborers are easily available in several states. So it is a labor intensive method. Now students, the advantages. Let's look at the advantages of transplantation method. Now if we go to a little flashback, we can see that as we are learning each and every method, we can see there is advancement. In the first method, there is wastage of seed, and then if we learnt in drilling method and transplantation method, that the wastage of seed has been minimized. So these are more developed methods, and there are several advantages of transplantation method. Let's have a look. First one, good quality seeds can be selected. Yes, as the seeds are first sown in the nursery, so the farmers can select best quality, higher and superior quality seeds, and then they can be sown in the nursery. So that when the actual crop is grown in the flooded field, then the rice which grows, the result of the production should be of good quality. Higher yield with fewer seeds. Now, as we have discussed, there is no wastage of seeds. So, the seeds are not wasted and a lot of crops production can be done. It allows quick germination of seeds. Definitely, as the seeds are put in at certain interval in the nursery where the all the conditions are taken care of, they are favorable, so the seeds, they germinate very quickly, and the seedlings are spaced out during replantation. It helps in plant growth. So when the seedlings are put in the flooded field, they are put at certain distance, and this helps the plant to grow well and nurture well. So these are the advantages of transplantation method. The fifth method is Japanese method. So let's have a look what is done in this method for cultivating rice. So the Japanese method, in this high yielding variety seeds are used. High yielding means the seeds that grow very quickly. And in this Japonica, which is a hybrid variety, it has been introduced by the Japanese, and this is grown initially in the nursery beds. So as we have learned in the in the transplantation method, that the first stage, the seeds are sown in the nursery. Similarly, in Japanese method also, Japonica, which is a hybrid variety, it has been introduced by the Japanese, it is first sown in the nursery beds, and then the seedlings are transplanted. Similarly, as it was done in transplantation method, the seedlings are transplanted in the flooded fields, and they are transplanted in rows so that weeding can be done, so that weeds, the extra grasses that grow, can be removed easily, and fertilizers can be provided to the field. For that reason, the seedlings are transplanted in rows. Heavy manuring is done along with regular irrigation. Means irrigation facilities are very kept prompt. It's regularly irrigation is provided along with heavy manuring, and as a result of such a lot of care and concern, 3 times more production, means 3 times higher yield is achieved in this method by following the Japanese method. So students, these are the methods of rice cultivation in India. Now we will learn about the method of harvesting and processing of rice in India. So after the rice has been cultivated, it is harvested. It is harvested by hand with the help of scythes and allowed to dry in the field for 3 to 4 days. After the crops are removed from the field with the help of scythes, and they are left, the uprooted crops are ripened crops, uprooted ripened crops are allowed to dry in the field for 3 to 4 days, and after that threshing is done. So they are threshed either by beating the paddy. Paddy means the stalks of the rice crop known as paddy. Paddy is against a wooden bar. They are beaten against a wooden bar so that the rice, the crop grain gets separated from the stalk. Students, look at the picture. This will give you a clear idea. Now this can also be done, the threshing can also be done by allowing the bullocks to just move over. If they walk over the harvested crops, then also to a greater extent threshing can be done. So this is another method. Just have a look at this picture. So this is how students, harvesting is done. After the crop is harvested, it is processed. So polishing is done, and polishing makes the grain attractive. It makes the grain look attractive. But most of the nutritional values are lost from the grain after it is polished. So unpolished rice is more nutritious compared to polished rice. Though the polished one looks attractive, but it is lacking in nutritional value. A lot of nutrition is removed as a result of polishing. So this is how after cultivation, harvesting and processing of rice is done in India. Now students, after this, we will learn the regions. Let us know about the regions suitable for cultivation or growing rice in India. So if we consider the regions, rice, main rice producing areas are river valleys, deltas and low-lying coastal areas. And if we consider state-wise distribution, then the major rice producing states are Tamil Nadu, West Bengal, Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, Assam and Maharashtra. So apart from these states, there are other states also where rice is grown, but these are the major rice producing states in India. So let's see the rank, which state is the largest producer of rice in India, and the answer is West Bengal. West Bengal is the largest producer of rice in India. The reason is moist and hot climate, and 3 crops of rice can be grown in a year. And the next is Tamil Nadu. Tamil Nadu ranks 2nd in India in the production of rice, and 15% of the total rice produced in India is cultivated in Tamil Nadu. So students, these are the methods of production of rice and the regions, and we have also seen the states where rice is cultivated or produced in India.
That's all in this module. Thank you very much.